just start, first of all, with the Courage Award. Darrell will be this year's 2014 recipient of the Courage Award. And the name, the Courage Award, it comes from boldly evangelizing, going out and sharing the faith, regardless of cost, regardless of criticism, just being a bold apostle for Catholicism. And we've had three prior honorees. The first year, then hitting coach of the Washington Nationals, Rick Eckstein. The second year, NHL legendary referee Kerry Frazier. And last year, former professional soccer player and then seminarian, now Father Chase Hilgenbrink. All wonderful honorees. In fact, Darrell, the first year when Rick Eckstein, our friend Rick, got the award, he had just donated his kidney to his brother Ken a few months before. And it was hard to get another honoree in future years because they thought they had to give some type of organ to get the award. But that's not the case. Darrell Miller, as you may know, is from one of the first family of sports in California, perhaps the first family of sports in the United States. He played for the California Angels. He was a catcher for 5 or 6 years, I believe, and a longtime scout for the Angels and still involved with the organization. Currently, Darrell is the head of Major League Baseball's Urban Youth Academy, their RBI program, Rebuilding Inner City Baseball, which, if you are not familiar, is one of the most wonderful and exciting initiatives of Major League Baseball. It's in essence, as I understand it, Darrell, is to promote and reinvigorate baseball in inner city America, where we had the greats, you know, Willie Mays and all the Hank Aaron, is to get another generation and generations of inner city African-American players involved in the game. Darrell has done a great job. Many of the players from the academy have been now drafted and are playing in professional baseball, and I'm sure Darrell will tell us more about that. The reason for the award here, though, tonight is beyond all the outstanding sports achievements for Darrell, but especially for his zeal for the Catholic faith. Darrell is a convert. I like to analogize him to Scott Hahn. Darrell, for a number of years, tried to lead people out of the Catholic Church because he believed that we were, I guess, something akin to the Antichrist. And then eventually became a convert, and now is spending all his energy and zeal going around the country speaking about his love for Catholicism and how important it is to him, his lovely wife Kelly, and their two beautiful children. Darrell is a real inspiration. In fact, usually when I introduce him, I call him my brother, Darrell Miller, but that's led to some confusion. People start to ask me if my name is Reggie. They say they must have seen my three-point shot. No kidding. Seriously, I cannot think of somebody who was less assuming, yet more deserving of this Courage Award. I would like to introduce my very dear friend, Darrell Miller, and give him the 2014 CAC Courage Award for Evangelization.
It was all I could do to get on a plane today and get out here because there's a lot going on in our family, and I had a very good friend die, and we're gonna eulogize him tomorrow, the next day, and we've had a hard time at our house and had a lot going on with my 16-year-old daughter, and I just want to thank Ray for the invitation and the honor. I don't deserve it. I feel like Paul. You know, I persecuted this church. I was just a mean guy, you know, and I really wanted to get all of you Catholics to become Protestant. And then I when I found out the truth, I thought, my God, I've been duped, and the truth is the truth. And you know, truth reveals truth, and I was so astounded that I was wrong, and because I couldn't be wrong. I'm Darrell Miller. I know a lot. But Ray, thank you. And the other reason I want to thank Ray is, you know, we've scratched the surface of Catholic Athletes for Christ, what Ray really wants to do. He has a vision and a heart for this ministry. And you see it being reproduced in this diocese. And the fruit is going to be born across the United States very, very soon, because it's what our church desires to happen. And Ray, thank you for your vision, number one. Thank you for your commitment to Catholic Athletes for Christ and forming this unbelievable organization. You have no idea how much this is needed in our country. Our athletes that we honor today, you have no idea the leaders you're going to be and what you're going to do to influence and move this needle forward in the United States, because this organization will revolutionize the way the Catholic Church is perceived in the sporting world in the United States. I believe it, I understand it, and we will see it happen in our lifetime. So Ray, thank you for your commitment and vision. You're an unbelievable man. There's a lot to say about our faith today. There's a lot to say about Pope John Paul II, who really understood the relationship of sports and faith, who really put it out there for us to really be a part and feel like we had a message, a place to say it. And he's also has challenging all of us to live our lives in a different way, all of us athletes, or those that pretend to be athletes like myself. I grew up not Catholic, and you know, I'm not going to go through the whole story, but you need to know that you know, I really did persecute this church and really didn't understand it like most non-Catholics. And so I'm a little apologetic, but I'm glad I'm coming from that perspective, because I'm a little bit like the Apostle Paul in that I'm really bold when I proclaim the gospel, because I know it's the truth. And I know that this church is founded on nothing but truth. So that makes me even bolder and more zealous, if you will, to really want our church to be understood in the right way. And so it's critical for us at Catholic Athletes for Christ, us athletes that are in high school and college and professional ranks, to really teach the gospel through the way we live. And we have to live loudly and also understand our faith. We have to be able to explain it. We have to be able to quote verses. We have to be able to understand how to really teach the gospel in every way, shape, or form. So it's critical that this is a really critical time for us. I'm going to take a little bit of time. I hope you guys have a little bit of time. What time is it? We now have a clock. Does anyone have a clock? My watch broke, so I don't have I got to set. Okay. So we'll take about 10 minutes. My coach at Cal Poly Pomona was Catholic. And he was the first Catholic that I ever met that I was challenged by spiritually to be a better man, a holier person. He was the first guy, let me back up. I was a linebacker, like our great friend over here from Notre Dame. I wasn't a middle linebacker. I was an outside linebacker, because only crazy people play middle linebacker. And I really wanted to play football. I thought I was going to play football. I thought I was going to play football in college. I was recruited to play at Arizona State and Stanford and other places, and I thought for sure I was going to play football. And they said I was too small, and you know, I weighed about 210, 220, I could run. I thought I was a pretty good player, but they said I was too small to play in the PAC-6 at the time. And the only thing I knew about Catholics was that our quarterback got recruited away from our high school. We were going to win state the year that he got recruited away, and he got recruited away by Notre Dame Catholic High School in Riverside. So the one thing I did know about Catholics is they stole players. That's what I mean. And so I had this bitter taste in my mouth, you know. Well, I wasn't as good as I thought I was, and then I ended up playing baseball, and I had a pretty decent year, got moved to catcher, and ended up playing at a Division II school called Cal Poly Pomona, California Polytechnic University at Pomona, in Pomona. And I played, it was Division II, wasn't, you know, no big-time program. And I was basically a walk-on. I had academic scholarships to go anywhere I wanted to go in California. And I met this guy named John Sklenis, and there was no drinking on the team, no smoking, no chewing tobacco, no cursing. They had just won the national championship the year before I got there. And the year we got there, they graduated a bunch of seniors, so I actually started as a freshman, and we were 17 and 40. We just basically were horrible. And it's really easy to not curse when you're winning, you know. It really is. It's really easy to be holy, and it's really easy to be, you know, you can say a lot of things when you're kicking everybody's butt. But when you're getting your hat handed to you every single day, it's a hard thing for those of you that haven't competed on a team. It's not easy to strike out. It's not easy to fail. It's not easy to go through this. So I'm coming in as a freshman, listening to all the stuff about we're not going to curse, drink, and I'm looking at our coach. I'm thinking, wow, we lost like our first 14 games that year, and we're playing. I mean, we weren't playing a bunch of, you know, sissies. We're playing USC, UCLA, Arizona, Arizona State. We're playing the powerhouses of the United States. And we're just getting smoked. So we were 0-12 after playing those four schools. And I looked at him in the dugout, and we had lost a game at Arizona State. And we were winning the game until the last inning, and we ended up losing. Matter of fact, I missed a pop-up. And I'll never forget, I expected him to, you know, any other coach I'd ever had would lose it. You know, we'd lost a bunch of games in a row. And he looked at me and he goes, "Guy, golly, Miller, good grief. I sure thought we had that one." I just looked at him. I go, "I cannot believe you didn't just curse me out." I mean, I cursed me out. And you got to find a quarter for every curse word. So I just put a buck in the jar, and that was an easy sentence because I probably, I, you know, anyway. So I guess for me, that snapshot into an unbelievably holy man that taught me how to be a better man. Some of the things that I learned, and some of the sayings I say today to all the coaches and kids that I coach and all the people that I influence, are that we all have the ability to influence somebody. We all have the ability, everyone in this room, someone looks up to you. And sometimes a lot of people look up to you. And so the question was always pointed at us athletes: how are you going to represent yourself, and how are you going to represent your school, how are you going to represent your family, and how are you going to represent God? Every single day. We talked about that. At a public school. How are you going to represent yourself? How are you going to represent your family? How are you going to represent the school, and how are you going to represent God? Every single day. We were challenged to be better men, better human beings, and to make a difference. How am I going to influence somebody in a positive way? Because we're going to influence somebody. Is it going to be positive, or is it going to be negative? Because we have the ability to influence. So in my heart of hearts, I thought, man, that's an interesting thing. How am I going to influence? This is a Catholic guy. And then he said that the biggest saying I got was, "Show me who you're running with, and I'll tell you what you are. You are who your friends are. Are you running with donkeys? You're going to be a donkey. You're running with stallions? You're going to be a stallion. If you're running with people that are going to influence you in a negative way, you're going to go down the tubes with them. If you're running with people that have the same vision or higher vision, if you're running with people that are influencing you in the proper way, you're going to get better. Surround yourself with good people, right? Simple, right? Right? If you want to be a better Christian, hang around better Christians. Very simple stuff. So that's basically how I decided I'm going to live my life. And all of us that were influenced by him, we all are the same people. We all hang together. We're still friends today. And I wonder, wow, what would I have been like had I not been influenced by him? How would I have been different? And so that's why I do what I do for Major League Baseball. You know, I've always wanted to be different. I've always wanted to be a leader. I've always wanted to influence for the good. And I'm lucky that Commissioner Selig and my boss is Frank Robinson. I work for a Hall of Famer. Who does that, right? Really? I get paid to go out and help people. Who does that? You know, how blessed am I to be in a situation like this? But that seed that was planted helped me to become Catholic. That and meeting this unbelievably godly, holy woman that I met, Kelly. You didn't corner the market. I got one just like that. So, I mean, unbelievably blessed. We have three kids and been married for almost 27 years. And when I became Catholic, the biggest impediment was going to confession. You know, because, you know, bottom line is, I'd been a pro baseball player. And I had sinned, and I remember laying in my bed going, why did I do that? Oh, my God. What, you know, going, please, God, forgive me, you know, and asking God to forgive me and hoping he did. You know, and some stuff only God and I knew. You know, most of it. And so I just was hoping. I was really hoping against hope he forgave me. And then when I had to go to confession to become Catholic, I mean, I really wanted the Eucharist really bad. I was like, golly, I got to confess all that stuff. I was 35 years old. I mean, think about it. I had sinned. And it's hilariously funny, and it's overwhelmingly painful. I was so scared because I didn't think God could ever for some of the stuff that I did. I didn't deserve to be forgiven. I should be dead. And I went to confession. I didn't know what to say. I didn't know how to say it. I didn't know how to make a good confession. I just poured my heart out to the priest, and he, you know, I left the confessional forgiven for the first time. I felt like a new human being. I'm sure no one here has ever sinned. You never had to go to confession. But I did, and I have. And I will, always, because there's nothing like the feeling that I get, that we get when we go and leave our sins at the foot of the cross with a priest. What an unbelievable gift. That's enough to become Catholic. That's enough. To know your sins are forgiven, to know you're separated from your sins. What an unbelievably, unbelievably strong gift we have in our faith. And then on top of it, to have the Eucharist, the body, blood, soul, and divinity every day if we want to, right, brother? And in Mass. How unbelievable is that to be Catholic? And we take it for granted most of the time. We're Catholic school. We're like, gotta go to Mass. Really? I gotta put on my sweater today. I can't go to, you know, we're moaning and bitching about, you know. I mean, my kids go to Catholic school. I'm like, really? Are we gonna go down that road? Are you kidding me? You should be sending we should be sending a limo to go to get the Eucharist. Are you kidding me? Really? Because, you know, in the early church, people died. Unequivocally were filleted, boiled, beheaded. Anyone that gave the Eucharist, you were a marked man. If you were the bishop, if you were in charge, they were trying to cut off the head. Really? And we're going to be that lackadaisical? I know you're the choir. So let me hear an amen, choir, amen. So you're the choir. You don't think this way. But what an unbelievable, unequivocally beautiful opportunity to receive Christ every single Sunday. And I remember when I went forward to receive Christ when I was 16 years old. I went forward because in our tradition it was, you would go forward and say, I want to receive Christ. And then you turn around to the congregation and they go, all right, Darrell wants to receive Christ. Everyone clap your hands. Well, I went forward like 6 weeks in a row because I really wanted God to know I meant it. And I couldn't get over that feeling of wanting to repent for my sins and receive Christ into my heart, which is what you're saying. You're praying this prayer of contrition and forgiveness and asking God to be Lord of your life. And so when I became Catholic, it made sense, because that's what we're doing every Sunday when we receive the Eucharist. It's what we do every single time we receive the Eucharist. We're giving our lives to Christ again. We're allowing him to be Lord of our lives. We're getting off the throne, and we're putting him on the throne of our lives. You know that, right? That's what we're doing when we receive the Eucharist. We're allowing God to be God, and we're getting off out of control. And we're letting him do it. We're surrendering everything we have to his influence on us. That's what happens when we receive the Eucharist. And I bet that's what you're thinking when you're walking up there. Huh. Sports is a fast-growing industry. We need to be vigilant. We need to speak this gospel and to evangelize not those that aren't Catholic. We need to evangelize those that are Catholic first. Because you know what? And we have I have a lot of evangelical guys that are going to, girls that are part of the solution. You guys that received your award, you guys are doing this already, huh? And sometimes you feel like you're weird or it's awkward. No one listens to you. And you're made to feel like, golly, am I the only person that thinks this way? No, you're not. No, you're not. And don't ever let anyone tease you or make you feel like you are weird, because you're not. You're exactly the way God wants you to be. And you're passionate about your faith and you stand up for it and you defend Christ. You're exactly the way you're supposed to be. You're doing exactly what you're supposed to do. You're not weird, they're weird. So never let anyone make you think that what you're doing is not what you're supposed to be doing. You guys, I'm so proud of you, because you are part of the new evangelization. And the rest of us, let's spread the gospel of Christ every opportunity we have. And that's why our new Pope is so amazing, because he's talking about love. He's just talking about, hey, who am I to judge? We just got to love everybody. And that's the good news. That's the good news, is God loves you. He loves me. He loves us so much that he sacrificed his only son. I wouldn't give any of my kids for any one of you. I like some of you guys. I like. I mean, you're nice people. I mean, there's some people here I like. But I'm telling you, but if you really analyze that, really, God loves us. And not only, it's just like, if you ever had somebody that really ticks you off and you go, well, you know, I'm going to let my son die for you, especially the one that cuts you off on the freeway or won't let you in or whatever. You know, we have those hand signals, tell them how much we love them. So we have to use sports to evangelize, you know. And it's hard, don't get me wrong. I coach, I mean, I coach my kids. I coach Little League, you know, I coach. And it's not easy, you know, getting your brains beat out and hitting 100 ground balls and having one go through their legs at the wrong time. You're like going, come on, really, you know? But we have to remember why we're playing sports. That's why what the Vatican is talking about is so important. We have to use sports to teach values, to teach you know, what it is to be more like Christ. If we're not doing that, we miss the sports boat. We just are being consumed like everyone else. We're being consumers. And we're part of the $270 billion market that just destroys people. That's all we're doing. And as Catholics, we're called to be more than that. Oh, absolutely are we called to be more than that. We have to really sit down, each and every one of us, holy Catholics that are here, and we need to gut check and make sure we're on track. You know, I need to gut check. I was at a soccer game this last weekend, and I have to keep shutting up. My wife keeps elbowing me. I sit there, and I'm watching my daughter play goalie, and I'm like going, those defenders aren't giving her a shot. You know, you're so critical of someone else's kid, you know. You're sitting there looking at them. And so my wife, she goes, you have to just shut up. I go, okay, I'm just going to shut up. So, I mean, I have times where before I go to a game, I go, I'm not going to say a word today. And all I'm going to do is go like this. Go team! Seriously. All I'm going to do today is I'm going to, like, get, like, some pom-poms, and I'm just going to go team. Go team. That's all I'm going to say the whole time. Go team. Great job. Seriously. Because after you've competed, you know, when you compete, you want to win. You know, all I want to do is win, you know, because you don't get paid if you don't win. No one's getting paid. Lord have mercy. So I'm part of the problem. I'm going to confession right now. Can we talk afterwards? I'm seriously going to confession. So we have a responsibility to change our paradigm. Adopt a healthier approach so we play and practice and encourage. We encourage everyone around us to be a better human being. And that's really why I do what I do. That's why I do what I do. And I don't do it well. You know, I'm guilty. I just mess up all the time. But I go back to the scripture in Corinthians. And for those of you that got married, you know, remember the chapter on love, you know, Corinthians chapter 13, verses 1 through basically the whole chapter. But, you know, you're talking about love is patient, love is kind, love is, we look at each other and you're going, I love you, babe. And your love is always, your love is this. You're like going, okay, that's what I am. I love you so much because that's how I always am. And we forget that's more of a rebuke, you know, because he's talking about, you know, how everyone wants to act like they're loving, and this is what love truly is. And he's really, Paul's rebuking the church of Corinth. And he's going like, a rebuke means he's like, spanking them, he's admonishing them, he's a little angry, okay? And at the end of this chapter, there's a great verse, and I think it's really important that, you know, I bring some kind of scripture into this. It's not all jokes. But in chapter 13, Corinthians, verse 11, he says, the Apostle Paul says to the church in Corinth, when I was a child, I used to talk like a child. I used to reason like a child. In other words, he saw things the way a child does. I used to think like a child, talk like a child, see things as a child does. But now that I have become a man, or now that I have become an adult, I have to put away all childish ways. And sometimes, you know, we're missing the game tonight, but you know how they talk about sports is it's a kid's game. You know, it's a kid's game. You know, well, you got to be like a little kid. You really do. You know, if you really analyze it, you know, playing pro ball, you almost have to turn off your brain and you have to become a little kid because it is a game. It's a game. I mean, people are making a lot of money, but bottom line is it's a game. It's a kid's game. But once we become adults and we look at sports from an adult perspective, it's from a different paradigm. We have to start really becoming adults. Not only in the way that we view sports, but the way we view our faith. it's no longer enough to just go through the motions of being Catholic. We have to actually be able to say something if people ask us a question about why we believe what we believe. Someone asks you something about Mary or about the Pope or about anything to do with being Catholic, you got to have an answer. You got to have some information. Do you know what I'm saying? I mean, you got to be able to say something. You got to have some apologetic books. You got to have a go-to phrase. You got to have a scripture, a couple bullets in your gun. You know? And I just, well, that's what I believe, and it's because my mom and dad were Catholic. You know? Why do you believe it's the body, blood, soul, and divinity of Christ? Why? Because no one else does. I don't know. Okay, that's a really good answer. And I'm not saying that we got to come down and we go 1 Corinthians. You have to be able to say, hey, absolutely. Paul talks about it a lot in Scripture. You know, John 6. You know, John 6:6:6. You know, there's something. Throw it out of them. That's easy to remember. John 6:6:6. Right? Throw it out of them. You know, when Jesus said, "You got to eat my flesh and drink my blood, or you can't have life," and everyone walked away. Really? Everyone walked away. I mean, that's the kind of stuff that's going to make people think. And you may not get them to do a whole lot then, but you know what? They'll go back and they'll go, wow, they had an answer for me. They had information. Because I love the way they live. I love the way they talk and the way they walk. I like the way they play sports. I like the way they are at school. I like the way that they work. They're always hard workers. They're always there early. They stay late. You know, I like the way that they treat their mom and their dad or their parents. Or I like the way that they treat their sisters and brothers. I like the way they treat their own children. God, they're good people. I respect them. You've already gotten them. Now let's seal the deal. Give them a little bit of information when they ask that question. Now let's set the hook. Because we're going to be fishers of what? Men. We're catching men alive. Right? We're always evangelizing. So, to close, what time is it? I went too long. Oh, my gosh. Thank you for the ability to have an award that I don't deserve. I just wish that I could do more because what God has done for me. I wish I could pay more. I wish I was a better person. I wish I was what I really want to be. And I know my wife gets on me all the time. She goes, "You just try it. You think you got to be perfect." I go, "Well, that's my goal. I'm trying to be perfect. I want to be a saint." Now my wife's a saint, you know. She just is. But I got to try to be. But thank you very much for the honor, and thank you very much for believing in me, Ray. And thank you very much for your vision again. And thank you very much, everyone that had anything to do with this night. What an unbelievably great night. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. Thank you.